written and woodcuts made by Peter Schumann, who is the director of the Bread and Puppet Theater, who is the person that many of us learned about this form from. And he could not be here tonight, and he asked us to perform this contestoria for him. And so, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, post-apocalypse for three-quarters empire.
Without hesitation or finality, a big fat tale of falling and rising, with citizens strategized to the unpromised land. Here. Resist and riot. What earth? What earth? What? 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 What?
Awake.
actors are all distinguished graduates of the School of Permanent War. What you see here is the unseeable. The black and white pane of torn apart entities, whether architectural or human, the dust that emits from the shambles of the performance, performed for a blindfolded audience. Here are two of Durer's apocalyptic writers. The substance of the performance is comfort the comfortable and afflict the afflicted.
Above occurrence.
Say good morning, but not a whole lot.
When I first moved to this town, I was duly warned by the last tenant before me that I wouldn't last too long unless I wanted to conform and kept my grass cut short. Better give my lawn a buzz cut or I might end up in court. She said she left that sleepless place with bags under her eyes. She let me have her earplugs. Here's the reason why. Snowmobiles roared by all evening, noon, and night. And the guy who lived next door to her thought it was his right to come and mow her lawn for her if he thought it was too long. He never even asked to strut his riding mower on to her lawn and start cutting. He'd lived there all his life, and as far as his cat lawns went, will be no wrong from right. I didn't want this good old boy roaming around my place. I don't like men in camouflage getting in my face. I really don't like conflict, so I kept my profile low, but I let my grass grow long and tall, and never ever mowed. But then one afternoon I heard that riding mower voice and summoned up my courage to confront that good old boy. He couldn't hear me shouting above that engine roar. Quite the introduction to my neighbor from next door. I waved my arm from my front step, tried to catch his eye. At last he cut his engine and I thought that I might die from nervousness or cowardice, but quietly declared, I rent this house and I can tend my own yard, so beware. If I want to keep my grass long, that's what I'm going to do. And how you keep your own grass, well, leave that up to you. He got off of his mower and he folded his strong arms. I folded mine the same way, trying not to look alarmed. He met my bluff and raised me one and looked me in the eye. And then he said, I'm Norman. I live just down the drive. My shock was great. I really couldn't quite believe my ears. Away went all my worries. Away went all my fears. I told him how the monarchs in Vermont are in decline, and that I was growing the wheat in that weedy yard of mine. Without that purple flower, the monarchs had no food to do their mass migration. And Norman just said, dude. Change doesn't happen quickly, not in days or hours, but sometimes I catch Norman admiring my flowers. Oh, I can feel the burn and I can speak my truth to power, but people here still mow their lawns as often as they shower.
Here we go, third time's a charm. Here we go, one, two. played with uppercase and lowercase and added unnecessary punctuation.
Thank you. people at our secret short hunt if we're going walking and we split up and we don't know where we are. I think we always use walkie-talkies if we split up. Next to Dunkin' Donuts, there's this trail that we know. This secret trail that we know. It's between me, my brother, and Elijah. We know it.
Probably the farthest boundary that we go is probably, well,
way down in the woods, like the whole woods areas. Yeah. It's like ours, the graveyard, the woods, everything in the woods is our territory, and like we know everything around town, but that doesn't mean we don't always not go to the bad places. We go there, walk through the places, the really broken stuff and stuff. You need to know where your places, good places are, your bad places are.
Attacker, they come to something and everybody runs away, but they don't hide. The zombie chases them, and there's an antidote which the people carry, and there's the zombie's poison, which the zombie can throw, and if it hits you at all, you become a zombie. So if someone gets tagged by the zombie, they have 10 seconds to be revived by the antidote, but they can only be revived twice. The third time, they automatically just become a zombie because the antidote just doesn't work anymore. Otherwise, zombies never win. But if the zombie somehow gets hold of the antidote and they get it to the original zombie, the zombies win and it's like over.
50, ready or not? Here I come.
When you play games, if you know where everybody is, you want to be quiet. When you don't know where they are, you want to say things that make them think that you're close to them. Like, I can see you.
There are people who are my friends, but only my friends when they're not with other people that are just their friends.
I'm friends with Elliot, but we're always friends. But if I'm friends, like I was friends with Abby and Riley last Monday, I wouldn't say that I'm necessarily that great friends with them right now.
But it's not usually like that. It's usually like 2 days they're friends with me, the next 2 days they're not. 2 days they're friends with me, at the end of the day, he's running, and then he yells, I'm not your friend anymore.
Okay, so where are we now? Oh, we're behind the rock. If they see me, I have to go right there so I can do good. Tell me more about this spot.
This is a good spot.
It's a really good spot, and we have all the places. Fifi and Ben would just win, because they want us to be tagged all together.
Stay here.
I had this little blue donkey figurine that I loved and I would play with constantly. And there was at one time a hole in this wall because the door had been opened too quickly and the doorknob had smashed into the sheetrock and made a hole. And the hole, of course, was incredibly compelling because you could look into it. It was just at the right height that I could look into it. I was about doorknob height. And I could look into the hole, but you couldn't see the bottom. You know, I could look down there and I could see that there was space and I could see this shaft. Anyway, I was playing with the little donkey at the edge of the hole. Like, of course, the donkey was climbing and wanted to, like, stand at the edge and look down. Well, you know what happened next? I dropped the donkey into the hole and then realized I could never get it back. Like, I had some understanding of the hole earlier. That was an incomplete understanding. And the moment I dropped the donkey down the hole, then it became a more complete understanding, which was that that's the wall. And like, no, your parents aren't gonna let you knock it down more so that you can get your blue donkey out. No, they're gonna patch over the hole and your donkey will be trapped in the wall forever.
There are several graveyards. There are three graveyards. But when we're like, hey, wanna go play tag in the graveyard? We always know that it's the big graveyard over there. It's not like one of the other two. But I don't know why that is, but we always think of it as that one.
I remember that we, as boys, love to play rabbits in the garden and go around and with our teeth eat the cabbages when they were half frozen and things like that sort. And in the bedroom where I stayed with my brothers, there was some kind of container or something, and the clothes that hung above it always looked like different figures to me. So I always saw different kind of giants or fairy tale characters in them. And in the, I think it was in the walkway up to where we had our room, there were cracks in the wall, and those cracks were people.
I don't really like being a seeker because I'm really bad at that. I'm only really good at hiding. Because I'm small, so I can fit through small places, like I said. And they think everyone is as big as them, almost. So they think I wouldn't fit through the small places, but I actually am. So I'm usually the last one to get found. So. They can't be the boss of me always.
Oh yeah, I have some treat.
Do you think you're gonna grow out of the neighborhood?
No.
I mean, eventually you're gonna grow up.
Yeah. Probably still gonna come back here eventually and just kinda see what it's kinda looked like in like 20 years or 30 years or something. I'm probably gonna come back and see what it looks like. see how much it's changed.